raise your right hand. I'm going to read these things to you. At the end, I'll ask you a question to which you'll say, I do. Thou shalt be scientific. Thou shalt seek truth. Thou shalt be rigorous. Thou shalt be original. Thou shalt respect thy mentor. Thou shalt not break the rules of the game. Do you accept? Sit down. That priest is really a pain. Sometimes it stays for a long time. It's hard to kick him out. So let's see what he prepared for me. Weird title. I have no clue about this title. So what I'll do, I'll just go through the slides and see what I can do with it. Design religions. Okay, so there could be two interpretations of the term design religions. Either it is about designing of religions, or it is about religions in the practice of design. Let's start with the first interpretation. Designing of religions. So clearly religion is a product because it has a purpose, goal, function. It helps people go over bad situations. It helps them answer difficult questions that they might have. It has a form. In architecture, there are scriptures, there are churches, there are habits, there are cultures around them, and a religion has customers that are willing to pay to own it. We contribute to our churches, and these customers obtain benefit from their products. Actually, religions are ingenious products. If you can think about it, it's probably they are probably the only products that survive for so long and still are virtually the same or closely to be the same as originated. There are no other examples of that nature. And really they are impacting the life of billions of people much more than Facebook. And if we study them, then maybe we can learn from the way that religion fulfill their function. And maybe we can learn from the process that created them. So let's try to see whether we can understand the process of how religions came to be. Actually, there are two ways, or maybe more, but I'll concentrate on two ways that religion might have emerged. One way is by design, and the other way is by accident or by chance. Let's go by the by design. So by design means that there is some intelligent agent that designed these religions, and that agent went through a careful design process. It went from thinking from the goals, and in the process, everything co-evolved. Unless, of course, you are God, then you know everything in advance. But if it was a human being, then it is different. And the process is governed by agent choices. In each step, we have several things that we can select, and we select the best thing, and here we arrive at our religion. Unfortunately, I'm not going to deal too much about designing religions from that perspective, but there are studies like historical studies and other things that try to analyze this path. Let's now think about it from an accidental point of view. So the second position is that religions arose by accident or by chance. Do we believe that? I mean, it's such a complicated product. So for example, think about the space shuttle. Would you believe that something of this can arise by chance? No. Okay, so go with me to say that religions is as complicated as this. It's an ingenious, really ingenious product. And I ask yourself, can you believe that religions arose by chance? Okay, let's get a vote. Let's do a social. Okay, who thinks it might be by chance? Okay, who thinks it's by design? Okay, and some people don't know, don't think. Well, never mind. Okay, so let's remember this example. We have not arrived at the consensus whether religion could be designed or could be arise by chance, but we do have a consensus about the space shuttle. There is no way that this that something so complex can arise by chance. Okay. So just as an anecdote, I don't know if you know the Daniel Dennett, the computer scientist might know him, but he's a philosopher that is one of the proponents of artificial intelligence, and he agrees about religions being brilliantly designed products. He actually thinks that religion ideas are similar to viruses that are threatening to replicate. And continuing along this, it's not a bad statement about religion ideas, because we can learn a lot from, for example, bacteria, how they communicate in the body by sending messages with all kinds of materials. Actually, we can learn about social network from them. There are interesting studies that I can mention about this. Okay, so let's see what can we say about religions by accident. And by accident, I mean really accident, and it's different from evolutionary development of product, like studies that Henry Petrosky has been doing about the evolution, for example, of useful things. He was tracing the evolution of, for example, forks from, actually, it's not on the picture, but from starting from a knife to prongs and then to the present knife. And his thesis is that form follows failure. We see that some designs fail and we go to correct them, and they may evolve in all kinds of ways. And at the same time period, he could have traced numerous designs that really try to overcome these failures and present better design to us. If you recall the figure from Verganti, this thing is talking about incremental design, okay? Because you view what exists there and you sort of do small modifications. And when I said something about evolution, I meant a different type of evolution than Lamarckian evolution, which is actually non-accidental, but there are incremental development steps that are done purposefully. Okay, so let's summarize what we learned from this topic. Could a religion might emerge by design or by accident? We don't know. Actually, in this room, we have no resolution, and I offer no resolution. We didn't learn much from that process. What do some people do when they cannot solve simple problems? What do they do? Pose more complex problems. Okay, so let me pose a more complex problem. Can we say anything about living organisms? Can we ask ourselves, are living organisms here because of design or because of an accident? Okay, so I'm going to look at these two, and I'll start with the accident. So here is Darwin. Here is his books from about 150 years ago. And by accident, I mean it's a process without purpose, goal, or meaning. The word meaning we mentioned yesterday. And the result is subjected to a test, survival of the fittest, nothing more than that. That particular theory is about, as I said, 150 years old. It's the only existing scientific alternative to this problem, and it's continually accumulating evidence, and it's socially acceptable, yes, within certain circles, But if you go outside to the countryside in many places, you'll find that it's not socially accepted. So there is also a debate here. Okay, now remember the space shuttle. Now I hope you agree with me that we are as complex as the space shuttle. Okay? So is there a chance that we arose by accident? A vote? Who think that we arose by accident? Who think by design? Okay, now it's clearer. Okay. By the way, I'm not making any judgment about which position is right, and we'll get back to this word judgment in this lecture. So let's now go to the emergence of organism or humans by design. So what this thesis says that we are here because some intelligent creature designed us, and there's actually a movement that is called intelligent design that is talking about that particular position. And the question is, can they demonstrate or defend their position? No, they cannot do this. There's a lot of evidence in this document that summarizes that, but I'll try also to give you a flavor of their arguments today, and I hope to convince you at the end. If you cannot defend your position, a good way to move forward is to attack. Okay? So what they do is they attack the evolutionary position using three arguments. One is probability, another one is the no free lunch theorem, and another one is atomic function. I'll go in detail into these three arguments. So, let's start with probability. Again, I present all kinds of figures to you, and I ask you to think, can something so beautiful arise by accident? Okay? It's a question. Now let's do an even more complex question. So this is the same place in the U.S. Before Hurricane Ivan, and this is after the hurricane. Okay, so we know that something like this happens in nature. What do the intelligent design people say when they want to apply the probability? Consider this rubble as raw material in nature, okay? And now we want to think, can somebody by chance assemble this into that? Okay, so clearly if we think, we cannot think of a hurricane that will do something like this. Okay, so they would like to use something along this line to refute the evolutionary position, because there's no chance that you can assemble something so complex for this from this stuff. Now I'll just give you a nice demonstration of it, and I'll show you how you can solve the Rubik's Cube very quickly. This was the hurricane, and this is evolution. Okay, so let me briefly now try to refute that particular argument of the intelligent design people. So what we have here, we have an example of playing cards, and we are dealing these three hands, okay? And we are trying to calculate the odds of getting these hands. So this is the calculation here. First, you have 1 over 52 to get the first one, and then the second one, and so forth. And these are the odds. So I ask now, is there a chance to deal something like this? Obviously you say no, but really these cards were dealt. Okay, we are talking about reality. So what is the problem with this argument? There are two things that are important in this argument. One thing is the direction of reasoning is crucial. Here we are seeing reality, and we are trying to calculate the odds of getting it, okay? When we go the other way, when we don't have that hand or these hands, and we are trying to predict what are the chances to get it, then it's improbable, okay? But this is something else. Predicting the future, we can use this to say it's improbable. But when we have a reality, we cannot say it's probable because it already happened, okay? So we have to remember that. And another thing is the structure of the argument is important, and I'll explain this in the next slide. So what's the argument? The position of the intelligent design is, if this is the rubble or the raw material, you cannot go to this in one step process by evolution. You have to exercise some goal-driven process. But really, evolution is completely different thing. You start, yes, with this raw material, but you progress in thousands and millions of paths in parallel, okay? And in each one, you're doing an incremental change. You're not getting from this to that in a single step. And in fact, if you trace the other path, it might have been that in many of them, you would get very interesting products, sometimes not far from what we are today. So really the chance is not this divided by the whole, how do you say, opportunities, but it might be that there are many, many more good designs here. And then, if you even wanted to exercise the probability argument, you have to divide all these by the number of paths. And the argument would be completely different. So, this one refuted basically the probability argument of the evolutionary. Now I want to ask, who has heard about the no-free-lunch theorem? One, I guess, yes, okay. Okay, a few, okay. So, let me go. So it's a theorem that coming from computer science, maybe a branch of machine learning, but maybe not particularly attached to that. But and it has a formal way to express it, which I won't go into detail or try to explain, but I'll just use the folkloristic explanation of it. So, any two search optimization algorithms are equivalent when their performance is average across all possible problems. What does it mean? If I have, a search algorithm and I'm trying to apply it to all problems that can possibly be formulated, then on some problems it will outperform all other methods. But this says that on some other problems, it will perform worse than the previously outperformed algorithm. So on average, everything is the same. Okay, so a corollary to that is that a general purpose universal optimization strategy is theoretically impossible. Okay, and there are exceptions to that, and I'll mention them briefly, but it's as a way to think about certain things, and also as an introduction to an argument by the intelligent design people, this is sufficient. So what is the argument of the intelligent design people against Darwinism when they try to use the NFL? So the argument is as follows. They are saying that even if there has been an accidental process, somebody had to go and design this fitness function that will control the emergence of good designs. Also, somebody would have to come in and design the sort of raw material from which the whole process starts. Let's say, design the DNA, okay, from which evolution can start. And actually, this guy, Dembski, published quite a number of papers in scientific journals on that. But when you go down and try to analyze the formal proofs and derivations, then you find errors in the theorems. So by now, we can drop this completely. Plus, it turns out that that particular theorem, the NFL, does not hold for biological evolution, and there are situations that you do get free lunch. Okay, there are exceptions to this theorem. So we were able to counter that argument also, and we are left with the atomic function argument. So what does the atomic function argument say? It says the following. Here is what is called a flagellum of a bacteria. This is a bacteria. This is the flagellum. This is a delicate propulsion system. It rotates here. And when the tail rotates, the bacteria moves forward or rotate or is doing what it needs to do to maneuver. So what do they say? If you look at this, this has irreducible complexity. So there is no chance that something like this has arose by evolution. Let me explain this in more detail. So what do the intelligent design guys say? The flagellum is very complicated mechanism, and it's composed of building blocks, actually about 50 building blocks, and none of them have a real function, serious function to exercise. So there is no way that you can assemble these to this by evolution. Okay, but this is their argument, and to be able to do something by evolution, you have to do something like this. You have to start with building blocks, but gradually, through very simple step, assemble them into things that do have function. So if I take, let's say, this and that, or let's say these two building blocks, I assemble them, suppose that this does have function, and then I combine this with that, it has more complicated function, and then I assemble it with something more simple, and I create the complete functionality, but by moving forward in these incremental steps. So in principle, if you could have something like this, then you could say that it's possible to get that complicated function by evolution. But the intelligent design people pick that particular organism and claim it's impossible. And they were wrong. Because if you take this, flagellum, then the material here is a protein that exists in the surface of cells and it's doing similar function. And this channel is present also in all cells. The rotary motor here that rotates and rotates the tail also exists in almost all cells because it's using to move materials back and forth outside and inside the cell membrane. And also secretion of protein through this tail is also taking place in different organisms. So in fact, you see all these functions in simpler forms in most organisms. And just to give you a more careful idea, so this is the complicated flagellum composed of 50 components, and this is another part of bacteria that is used to extract materials into other body cells when they want to attack, for example, a cell. So there is a needle there. I mean, basically the same thing. And you see here that these are different, the same parts. So these are 10, this is composed of just 10 parts. So really, in opposition to the intelligent design position, claiming that the 50 parts are so complex that they cannot be created by evolution, we see intermediate designs, okay, and we see parts of it in other cells, so it's really breaking completely that particular argument. So really, the intelligent design people really did a bad job in presenting this organism, because we can find counterexamples to this one. Maybe if they looked harder, they would have found something that would be more difficult for the evolutionary guys to refute. But they did a bad job and they presented a bad case. Okay. So what happens when you have two positions and people don't come to conclusion? We get into places that we probably would like to avoid. So what happens, and this is a real situation and real problem, and actually we can pose it as a design problem, because it happened in some district in Pennsylvania, and there was a clash there between the parents and the school management. The school management wanted to introduce intelligent design studies into the curriculum, and the parents didn't want that. And of course, when you disagree, it end up at the hand of the court. Okay, so it came to that particular judge, which is a Republican and churchgoer. Okay, and he had to rule basically that intelligent design is a religious view and not a scientific view. Okay, so he stated that intelligent design violates the centuries-old ground rules of science by invoking and permitting supernatural causation. It relies on flawed and illogical arguments, and it attacks on evolution. Have been refuted by the scientific community. Okay, so you can agree with any of the position, it doesn't matter. At the end, in such situation, there is a result, and if we like it or not, we have to live by it. Okay. By the way, so I'm coming back to the designing of religion. Some of you may have heard of Edward de Bono. He's a great creativity guru, and just a few years ago, he designed a religion. Okay, so he took some of the existing religion, obviously modified them, and claiming it is a better one. So you see that it's not such a mysterious idea to design a new religion. Okay, let's discuss a little bit about that emergence of organisms. So let's talk about evolution for a second. Let's bring up some positive arguments about evolution. So, by the way, I hope that now you agree, or maybe not agree, but those who voted for us emerging by evolution should be satisfied. Those that voted for us being here by in design might not be satisfied, but it doesn't matter because the judge ruled. Okay? So as far as practical reasons, this is now the rules by which we have to live or have to accept. So evolution clearly is a powerful strategy, and it's extremely simple. I mean, it can be very, very dumb. You don't have to be so knowledgeable. You just have to place a survival of the fittest test and some evolutionary rules. But it tells us if something so simple can achieve so much, then we need to worry about not complicating things too much sometimes. Reverse engineering nature is a tough task. It's interesting because if we can get such a benefit by evolution, maybe we can do a reverse engineering and try to learn from nature. So this is an interesting field called biomimicry. So anybody that is doing design should know that we can take an interesting concept from nature. And this is a study by my PhD student. We are trying to learn how different things that we find in different organisms that look different, but really there is something fundamental below them. For example, here, repeat protrusions in different organisms like shark, butterfly wing, and so forth. They are used to attach or detach different materials, different surfaces, and also repeated tubes, channels that exist in different organisms are used to transmit material, and so forth. We have a list of these patterns. So it's an interesting subject. The negative part about evolution, that it takes a long time and it's really wasteful. And in most cases, we cannot exercise such a strategy, but really do need to solve a problem efficiently and quickly. But as a strategy, it's a challenge to design. Another thing that we need to consider related to science from the scientific position is that also science have its limit, and even in physics there is no agreement on the grand theory. And if you look at relativity theory by Einstein or quantum mechanics by Bohr, you see these guys in the house of Einstein sitting and talking, in spite of them being friends and having arguments over a long period of time, they haven't come to an agreement, and there is no agreement in physics about a grand theory. And just a recent book by Hawkins saying the same things, we should forget about the grand theory. So even in physics, we don't have grand theory, and even math also can be tricky. Being formal might not be correct sometimes, and sometimes things are decided by social process. So if these things happen in science, we should not think that in design, we would have a single best method in something or a single design theory in something. We clearly need to embrace multiple perspectives. Okay, let me now turn more briefly into the second interpretations, religions in the practice of design. So you have learned number of methods, and you will get to know more methods in your career, and you'll find consultants coming to you and telling you, I can teach you now the best method that exists, everybody in the world is using it, you should use it, and so forth. And some of these names are QFD, TQM, Six Sigma, quite similar ideas in different names that come and go as generation of designs come in, because consultants need to earn money and they need to invent new ways to talk about similar things. And such obsession with methods or my way is better leads to failure, and no freelance theory predict that, but we also know it from our experience. So we really need to know the strength and limitations of our methods, of ourselves also. Now, it might be less of interest now to you because you are sort of in the beginning of your career, but those of you who are going to continue to do research at some point, there are religions in design research. There are people who try to take artificial intelligence and say it can be the foundation of a theory of design, and some people optimization design theory. And we as a community, We are sometimes obsessed with science, rationality, formalism, and scientific method. Okay, we think that there's just one way to do science, and sometimes such obsession could have negative effect, and this is a cover of a book called Voltaire's Bastards, and he's showing how by taking rationality to an extreme, you can create bad effects. So we really need different perspective, different theory of science, of design. If you wait to a book that, as I mentioned yesterday, I'm presently writing, we try to show that really a good theory of design need to embrace multiple perspectives, because one perspective is insufficient. And you may say, well, but this one theory of design is also one design theory, so should there be things in parallel? But this can lead to infinite recursion, okay? But this is something that we have to deal with when we talk about design. Another point is that there are some non-intersecting viewpoints or religions in design. I'll briefly mention one thing in particular, because it was, it's something that happens along, three decades, or at least two decades. There is one movement in design research that is called decision theory, and they advocate for that this is the way to do design research, and also that if you want to use design methods that are based on their theory are the one that should be used, and they are attacking methods like QFD, pure concept selection, and others, because they are empirical and you can easily create examples that will show that some of the things do not work properly. But they claim that their stuff is usable for practice. The other guys, those that try to propagate things like those empirical methods like pure concept selection, QFD, do not claim that their stuff is a theory of design, but they claim that their stuff is useful to do practice. And there is a clash when you try to say, or when you blur the boundaries, when you say that the methods that are based on decision theory work in practice, where in fact you do not demonstrate that. So moving across boundaries where you when you don't have the evidence is a little difficult problem. So if you design a product, this is the last point here, if you design a product, you need to practice your design seriously. And just two examples, the intelligent design people fail, at least in one case, in presenting their case to the court in Pennsylvania. The three arguments that I mentioned, the one probability, the no free lunch, and the atomic function, these are the arguments that were presented in the court in Pennsylvania. And if they did something like failure mode and effect analysis, thinking about how can my argument fail in court? They should have checked, for example, the argument about the basic function, and by really easy check, they could have seen that this argument simply does not hold. So they did really a bad design job in designing their argument. And I may say that also De Bono, when he designed his new religion, did not such a good job, because he was changing some aspects of existing religion, and he wasn't really propagating his changes to see what might be the effect. So one may predict that if his religion is adopted a little, it will die after a very short time, something like this. So this is not also a great design. Okay, let me move on to some of the conclusions of the talk. So really, there is no single method better than other. If a consultant tells you something like this, he is wrong. If you tell me that you empirically proved, and the proved is the important word, that you improved your method is better than others, I'll say you have no clue about science. First, you cannot prove in science. This is one thing. If you tell me that you provide support that your method is better than others, and you don't tell me what are the limitations, what is the scope of your statement, but you say simply better than other, period, I will say that you didn't listen to the talk. So really, there is no single best selection method between alternatives. It's relevant to you in the course. And sometimes, when you use a particular method, it might be valuable to defend the choice of the method for the particular problem, because some method will be good for some problems and some will not work for those problems or will be bad choices. And there is no single super designers. Design should be done in teams. And teams can present some free lunches. And I may get in trouble in some places. There is no single design, I didn't say there is no single religion better than others. I'm saying there is no single design religion better than others. And if you want to pick a religion, being a designer, then pick whatever you want, but leave you with your conscience and accept the consequences. Okay. Don't confuse your religion with science or truth. It is a faith. It is a religion. And don't even confuse science with truth. One thing that I mentioned yesterday is if you have customers and you ask them or you design something for them, think of it as designing for yourself also. And this is a statement by, it's an old Jewish statement, but we all know it, practice what you preach. So if the core of engineering is design, and as engineers, we need to use design in our own practice, as design researchers, at least some of us in this audience, we should use design or research product in our practice. So for example, if I'm developing a design selection method, wouldn't it be appropriate if I use that selection method when I'm trying to design, let's say, my new house, or if I'm now designing my next trip, my next holiday trip, should I exercise the same research products? Because if I'm asking others to use them, should I use them myself? Well, I can go on with this argument. But I have a sense that another priest is coming. Are you nervous? There are places in Earth that presents different challenges than designing the next gadget. These challenges might be really hard work problems such as sewage, transportation and pollution in exponentially growing cities, or coming up with affordable housing, affordable food, affordable healthcare. And challenges request our humility and appreciation that there are things that are bigger than us. They ask us to be empathic, relevant, valuable. Do not assume that you have sole knowledge or methods, so please be creative in addressing critical world problems. Practice your design reflexively. Design your careers, your research, your proposal, your research papers. Walk on the wild side and enjoy designing as much as I did in this talk. Thank you, but this is not... This is not the end. So, to finish this lecture, what I'd like is to sing with you this song. So it's a kind of transformation, a little bit odd to do it in a talk, but you can join me. Nobody is going to say you are lousy singers. I mean, there are going to be a lousy one on stage, so don't worry about it. And if you think, should I not? Why not? It's an opportunity. Use whatever opportunity you have. Oops. And now the end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friends, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I've traveled each and every highway. I did it my way. say.